we need to find partners to help us do what we do. We collaborate with everybody. So we collaborate with the Cleveland Orchestra. The Cleveland Orchestra provides us with the instruments for our El Sistema Orchestra Music Program and provides an opportunity for our kids to perform on stage at Severance Hall. We collaborate with the Cleveland Museum of Art. During our summer camp program, the museum sends in teaching artists, and in the last 2 years, they've worked with our kids to create beautiful boutique banners. The banners initially get displayed in the museum and then come to Rainey for permanent display. And it's an exciting thing to see for kids, for families, and for me, to see our kids' work being displayed in the Museum of Art. All right, 2 years ago, we wanted to start a ballet class for our kids. So we collaborate with Groundworks Dance Theater, a local professional dance company. So one of their professional dancers comes in twice a week and teaches both a beginning ballet class and an intermediate ballet class for our kids. And when Groundworks does their professional performances in Cleveland, they provide free tickets to our ballerinas and their families to go see their teacher perform. We collaborate with American Greetings. So American Greetings has a lot of young, extremely artistically talented people. So the American Greetings Young Professional Resource Network has adopted Rainey Institute as their collaborative partner. And American Greetings professionals come in and do workshops for our kids, do school supply drive for our kids, and each year have a social event to raise money for us. We collaborate with PNC. So PNC's philanthropic focus is preschool kids. And PNC funds our collaborative program for preschool students. We collaborate with Hathaway Brown. So we've done things over the past several years with the middle school GROW program. We've also partnered with Stephanie Heidemann's class and program, and HB students come and visit us and see what we do. And we currently have one HB student that comes to our after school program on a weekly basis and just talks to our kids. So we have learned that the power of partnerships and collaborations and working with organizations that have resources that can help us do the things that we do for kids tremendously increases the impact that we have on the kids that we serve. How am I doing on time?
You're doing so well. Although I'm not paying attention because I'm so into the presentation. You didn't know you had a presentation, but I got one.
You know,
thank you so much for all that you share. I mean, your organizations are incredible. And you think of a time when we're losing connections to one another, and also so many kids are losing connections to the arts and to, you know, being creative human beings in schools. We're so lucky to have all three of you in the Cleveland area. So I think before we go to lunch, we've always got food online, but we've got a good, you know, almost 15 minutes where we can do some Q&A, which I think would be really helpful. So I'll let you, anyone with questions? Got 15 minutes to fill, people. Oh, yep.
Hi, the Rainey Institute. So where do you get your art supplies? I mean, is there a...
All right, so we always welcome donations of instruments,
good,
art supplies, and money.
Perfect.
All right, and again, one of the exciting things about our partnership with American Greetings is they're building a new headquarters.
Yes.
So they need to get rid of everything in the old building. So we said, we're here.
Right. Good.
I would also just add for anyone that the panel has alluded to some of the programs at HB. So just so you know, there's a Center for Civic Engagement at Hathaway Brown School where girls do coursework over 4 years. And then they also are placed outside of the school into the community where, and I think Amy spoke to this very well, they learn about the real complexities of what it means to be running a nonprofit, who are the people that you serve, the ins and outs of it. They take a very academic approach to it, as well as getting hands-on experiences. So just to throw that out there.
We also, I work with the middle school girls, and we had our proposal review last week. We talked about writing some other student requests and putting proposals. It's really, it starts early. These girls learn a lot about even grant writing, what that, where those sources come from. So that's really great.
How much support do you all feel you get from the city of Cleveland, the state of Ohio? What can be done? I'm sure resources are incredibly tight. But you are filling a need.
In the Rainey world, we're fortunate to be in Cuyahoga County that has a cigarette tax that funds arts organizations. So
go out and smoke.
Keep smoking.
It helps us. We also receive funding from the Ohio Arts Council. And that's really the extent of government funding that we receive.
We get a little bit more in Cleveland Heights. A year ago, we applied for Community Development Block Grant money, CDBG funds, from the city of Cleveland Heights. And we opened up a satellite after-school program in a neighborhood that's the most economically, the lowest economically, I guess, demographics in Cleveland Heights. It's at the Noble School. It's also the farthest school from our center. So all the other elementary schools can be bused to us, and the time is adequate. They get there in enough time. The kids from Noble, they weren't getting to us till 4:30, which meant they had about an hour. So we received some funding to run a satellite after school ink spot at Noble Elementary 2 days a week. And it's a huge help. The paperwork that is attached to it is huge, because anytime you get government funding, you have to provide, one, we have to request information from families that sometimes is hard to get, and the reporting is, it's a whole other set of sort of standards from just general foundation reports.
I was just wondering, sounds like the schools are one resource as far as how you connect with students, but for the Rainey student, like Erin, how do students find you for some of your programs?
Postcards. It's a tricky, for us, myself and the co-founder were working pretty closely in the schools before we opened up Lake Erie Inc. We have a lot of connections with a lot of different schools, not just in Cleveland Heights. I was actually running programming for the Shaker Heights Youth Center, and doing a lot of work with kind of youth resiliency. And so there's a huge youth network of providers of programming. So you just send things out and you hope that people kind of take it into their organization and presentations where somebody might hear something and they might make a recommendation to somebody else. A lot of times it's just building a network. And you just never know. One of the things for us, I don't want to go on too long, but we run a monthly program that's funded from CAC, the Cuyahoga Arts Funding. One of the things that happens at that program is if we get picked up on the radio, so if it's a cool enough program where we get PR, and we never know if we will, a parent will hear it somewhere and see it, and they'll pass the word on to their, and then all of a sudden you get kind of a different community finding out about what we provide. So it just, I feel like it can be hyper-local, and then it can also be extended out through networks.
All right, and in the city of Cleveland, the sad news is there are not nearly enough good, positive, effective out-of-school programs for kids. There just aren't. The good news for us is, because we've been doing this for a long time, we don't need to do a whole lot of marketing of our programs. So. In terms of our summer camp program, we started registration in January. We're 3/4 filled now. And again, it's because there aren't nearly enough programs for kids.
Transportation is an issue, I will just say. I know for us, there are a lot of kids who would like to come to us who can't get there. And that's just an issue. We're not on a major bus line. High school kids, they can sometimes do it, but the younger kids, the parents are reluctant to.
I was just going to ask you, Mark, if you could talk a little bit more in depth about how schools pick up the Facing History Ourselves curriculum. Like in the eighth grade at Hathaway Brown School, it's really incorporated into it. So how do you work with schools when you're putting that together?
But you know, it's similar to but not with Lee. Lee, you know, you've been around so long. Not you. But I think we share similar struggles getting the word out. It's not always easy. So it's about building relationships, building networks, being creative with educational partners. It is really about building partnerships. So going to our funders and asking them to sort of promote us in various different places. You know, presenting at conferences like this, or going to you know, social studies conferences, teacher ELA conferences, or even using the Education Service Center, which is a consortium of about 100 different school districts through Cuyahoga and the other counties that provide Education Service Centers. So we just developed a relationship with them, and so we're starting to work in Solon and Rocky River and places like that where we've never been before. But it's not easy. Schools are hunkered down now, and they're siloed, so it's hard to get the word out.
And you actually go in and work with the teachers on creating a...
Yeah, we provide coaching, on-site coaching with that too.
And along with that, Mark, could you talk a little bit on your website, because there are so many fabulous resources available just through the website. Can you talk a little bit about
that? Sure, I only had 10 minutes, so I couldn't do anything. So this is going to change on Monday, so it won't look like that on Monday. It's actually going to be much more user-friendly. If you sort of hover over the educator resource tab, I mean, there's so many different, so if you go down to educator resources. So we have resource collections around immigration or the Holocaust or civil rights, from movies to books that we loan. We have a lending library of 6,000 videos that we send out to teachers. If you go down, if you hover over for educators, and so there's featured projects, lessons and units, you know, readings, you know, all, you know, you can see. So it really is extensive. It's part of, you know, a teacher that comes to one of our trainings is, you know, stuck with us for life. We have a relationship with them. So can I pick on you, Libby? And so somebody from my staff, not me, next week, I wanted to, but we'll go into Libby's class on it, and we're going to do a lesson together around the steps to mass murder. And so that's how it works. We have a coach. I'm Libby's coach, or she's my coach. and we work that way. So thanks for asking.
As a startup nonprofit, we're looking to establish our volunteer base with corporate partnerships to bring a consistent volunteer base. How do you manage to retain your volunteers? Because it's easy for someone to come in 1 hour a day, once a month, and then they just forget about it. My name is Erica. I am a part of Empowering Youth with Swarm Justice Law, my mom and founder. Cleveland, and we're already filed. So if anyone, and that's that question for you, how do you, any tips to retain your volunteers?
Well, I was just going to say, I think a lot of it is using them. I say that honestly. If you go to our website, we have some kind of volunteer testimonials, and one of the things is that when they come in, we don't have them in the back office doing stuff, even though we need them there often. We really want to make sure that they feel and what they do is meaningful, and so we talk to them a lot, so we have a very clear process. So they apply, they're interviewed, and then they're trained, and then we do a lot of check-in with them. And so again, one of the other schools we work very closely with is Beaumont for the last 4 years, and they are required to do so many hours, and so we will see the girls sometimes for all summer, you know, they'll kind of run off summer camp, and then they're done with their hours, and they show back up in the fall. And I say, oh, this is great. Did you not get your hours? I just wanted to come and hang. And that happens all the time. And I think it's in part because we give them some independence. So we kind of also, so conversation, we do trainings and we do check-ins. So fall, winter, spring, we do a dinner, we gather, we get some feedback. High school volunteers are only one component. We work with four different universities in the area, and we specifically partner in the English department and in social work and in education, because those are kind of the three areas where we're working. And then we also work with seniors, so we have quite a few people from the community. So the volunteers are really part of a pretty active network themselves, and they feel like they belong. And we include them in everything we do. So we publish, we publish student writing, and a lot of times we didn't do it in this one, we'll put in the volunteer writing as well. So they're really invested in what, in the organization.
I provide a slightly different perspective. As a small organization, we need to be careful that we're not overwhelmed by volunteers. Mm-hmm. So when we get those calls from big businesses, can we send 40 people to spend a half a day with you? We've learned the lessons the hard way. It's not our mission to entertain volunteers. It's our mission to serve kids. So we look at the volunteers very strategically. And if we can't find a way for volunteers to help us serve kids, we say thank you for your offer, but we just aren't staffed to deal with requests like this.
I'd be happy to talk to you more about it because we're local, but BVU is a great organization locally. Have you connected with them?
Yeah.
Okay.
I just had a question about for the Rainy Institute. 1904.
What did that look like? So Eleanor B. Rainey started the organization as a private charity. Okay. The original mission was to help immigrants who settled in our neighborhood in the early 1900s. So the organization was part of the early settlement house movement. So we helped new Americans from 1904 up to the 60s. And by the time we get to the 60s, the flow of immigrants to our neighborhood had ended. The neighborhoods had changed, the needs changed. And that's when the organization realized that it needed to change. So we went through a strategic planning sort of process and changed our mission to become a community arts center for kids. So we've been doing arts for kids since 66.
And under Lee's leadership has built this beautiful buildings on East 55th, so it's gorgeous.
Yeah, we were actually, so Eleanor B. Rainey built a building in 1904. We were in that building for 107 years. and five years ago, we moved four blocks down the street into our brand new beautiful facility.
So 55th and what?
Payne.
I do. Mark, this question is for you. I'm interested in why you chose history. In other words, facing history, why history was the vehicle by which you're doing all these things.
Are you a board member? Because, board member asks us all the time because we actually get caught up. What we're trying to do is shape a teaching practice, mm-hmm. right? And so we started as an organization that used our original case study was a historical example, which was the Holocaust. We have since grown over the 40 years, and our work is more about the pedagogy we do than the content we use, but we're stuck with a name that sometimes confuses people. And actually doesn't allow us to get in the door, so.
Mm-hmm. And the other thing I was going to suggest is if you have an international component, on August 19th, 1991, where I was teaching in Russia, we had to throw out all the books because all the books had to deal with Karl Marx, and they may be coming back into session with Joseph Stalin,
yeah.
And so all the books were reformulated. So yeah. It might be a sort of green pasture for your organization.
Yeah, that's great, thanks, yeah. It's exciting.
Well, I'm sure that they'll leave you around for just a few minutes after this.
It's a free lunch.
So, thank you for attending this. The lunch is downstairs, and I want to thank the three of you so much.
We have some handouts, I think, so if you guys want
to... Lots of literature to grab, and I also tried to put all their websites up there so that you could see those. And thank you so much. Enjoy the rest of the conference.
Oh, you're welcome.
You're welcome.
This is...
working with you.
Yeah.